Irreverent, entertaining, cool. You're listening to LA Talk Radio.
You're listening to Reza Riffs with Keith Reza and Alan Lee right here on LA Talk Radio.
All right, guys, welcome back to the show. We're live in studio with Alan Lee.
What?
Are you on?
Testing 1, 2, 3.
Okay.
I'm using my...
Should have done that before the show started.
Our guest was doing it. I was okay. Following suit.
Excellent. We're back in the studio with the great Barry Katz.
Yes,
he's the host of Industry Standards, which is on iTunes and all the podcasts. And you're the biggest comedy manager in the world.
That's the one.
And
It's an honor having you say lies to me.
What? No, you are.
I can't believe I get to sit next to a person who's actually referred to as we.
Me or Alan?
Alan we. Yeah.
Like your co-host, it's like we. It's like automatic fun.
Yeah, yeah. He likes that. And then, like, because, like, when I picked him up, I was like, Barry's going to be in studio. He's like, oh, I'll bring Barry up on the elevator. I was like, well, he wanted to talk to me. And he was, like, all jealous. And then, like...
I was trapped in the elevator because a logistics problem.
I never thought, you know, I'd have a co-host who's dressed in a tuxedo.
Yeah, oh, I was like, why are you wearing a tuxedo?
But it looks like he had a one-night stand, like, three years ago, and he's wearing the same suit. It's fantastic. I'm sorry. I don't mean to say that. I'm really not a bad person.
No, not at all. At all. I'm a fashion guy. I just really ruffled look today. I thought it might be okay.
Alan, Barry was telling me on the phone earlier about this guy who wrote a movie. And then we go in the movie.
Victor Levin. I interviewed him. He ran Mad About You for years. Mm-hmm. And he's, you know, been a writer on, you know, Mad Men and so many other shows. Mm-hmm. But he wrote a movie recently and directed it called Destination Wedding, and with Keanu Reeves and oh my God, this is going to have to be
Winona Ryder.
Winona Ryder, thank you so much. And so it was an amazing interview, and the movie is incredible because they're the only two people who speak in the entire movie. There's people all around, but that's the way it is, and there's so many jokes per minute, which I think is the key to success. And I was telling your host about this, Alan.
Yes.
And it is Alan, isn't it?
It is indeed Alan Lee, or we.
It's Alan Wee. We're changing your name to Wee.
I appreciate that.
Got it. And so there's no we in I.
No.
So we're talking, Keith and I are talking about it, and it is Keith, isn't it?
Yeah. Mine's pretty normal.
Race there up. Is an I in Keith.
Yeah.
Anyway, so... So, and then I'm on the phone prepping with him, and then we go in the lobby, and who comes out of the elevator? Victor Levin.
I know. Wow. That's a sign, isn't it?
Wow.
Yeah, that's like a huge... I believe in signs. Do you believe in signs?
I did until I met Alan.
I'm sorry.
You might know Alan because he stalked all your previous clients, you know, like Dave Chappelle and all that stuff. So you might know.
That explains why I've been fired so many times.
That was me in the shadows.
You couldn't keep Alan Wee away from me.
Well, it was a career move.
You know, when I look at you two together, and this isn't the way I wanted to start this, I'm so sorry.
We're sorry.
This isn't the way I normally do this, but I look at you two together and I think of that famous phrase, one of these things is not like the other.
Yeah, definitely.
But I'll let you be the judge of which one.
Yeah. Well, it's weird because, like, people don't know that we get along so well because we have two different personalities, you know what I mean? And, like, I'm just like, oh, whatever, and he's more like, you know, very...
I don't drink milkshakes like you, though, because being half Asian, you know, we can't, you know, dairy. We get pimples, zits, and...
So you learned the most random thing ever. You just
I'm adding to the conversation. Excuse me.
Alan, do you want to ask Barry your serious question?
Well, I know I've done my research. He does TED Talks with a girl.
You did TED Talks?
Yeah, on karma and God.
I've never done a TED Talk.
No, she wanted him to do a TED Talk.
I would have loved to have done a TED Talk. I've never done a TED Talk.
I've always wanted to do a TED Talk. I think that would help my comedy career because, like, all these TED Talks, they get, like, 3 million, you know, viewers and stuff, and I could just talk about my comedy
for
to Ted.
Three. Oh, two.
I think you should just have Ted talk to Alan.
Well, that'd be interesting. I have some questions, Ted.
You're like, all right, we're here with Alan Wee.
That's right.
What's your inspirational thing? I don't drink milkshakes.
Well, I threw that in, and everyone knows that, you know, if you have Asian blood, it's hard to digest the milk. And so...
Did you know that, Barry?
I knew that as much as that I did a TED Talk. You know, I have a question for you, sure. Alan. I can't believe I'm asking questions.
No, asking questions.
This is the most bizarre start to any podcast I've ever done in my life. I just want you to know that.
Thank you.
But you're welcome. I want to ask you, like, and you probably asked this before.
Many
but,
times.
And try to take this with the spirit it's intended. So... Men of all races
sure.
gravitate and love Asian women and mm-hmm. always want to mm-hmm. be with an Asian woman, always
sure.
want to hang out, even if they're friends, mm-hmm. girlfriends, whatever.
Sure.
But why is it that mm-hmm. all races don't want to be romantic necessarily mm-hmm. as much with an Asian man? I'm not making a joke. Mm-hmm. I'm asking you a serious question.
Well, being a half Asian man, I'd say that
Which half?
My dad, my father, my mother's Cuban. I mean, she's Cubanese. It's a routine I do. You probably find a hack, you know, it's because I'm Cuban. But answering your question, I think they're fearful of a certain a repressive dominance in Asian men
right.
when they communicate. They're kind of nice, you know, but they're saying cook my rice now, underneath the niceness.
Right.
Does that make any sense?
No.
Yeah, that's actually a phrase that I can honestly say I've never said in my life. Cook this rice now. The second most frequent thing I've never said is, when am I doing that TED Talk?
I told you this is going to be one of the best ones you've ever done. Because
bizarre.
We have no scripts, you know what I mean? Like, people go with all these questions, and it's like, I just want to talk and have fun, you know? But I do have a question for you.
I'm here.
So, you've been managing all these great comics, and you're still doing that. What do you find, like, so special about that? Because you obviously really love comedy.
I love comedy. I love comedians. I love their stories. I think that anyone listening, if you have a great story, it doesn't matter if you're a mm-hmm. comedian or a banker or a 7-Eleven manager, if you have a great story, you're in great shape, because what is it that you want in your life? You want to have a great job, and you want to have a great relationship, or if you don't want a great relationship, you want to be able to meet and be with anybody you want to be with at any time. So if you have great stories, whether you're a man or a woman, you're always going to be in that position. Look, mm-hmm. you know, I look in the mirror and, you know, after I get out of the shower and I see a bag of onions. I'm not a bag of onions. But when I go out in the world and if I can tell a great story, I'm in pretty good shape wherever I am, at a party or people I don't know, or even, God forbid, if I find that woman's prison and I get on a date,
ooh,
I can actually, you know, tell a story. And so that's the biggest thing about comics is that normally they have great stories. Mm-hmm. And the other thing that they have is that most of them are broken.
Yeah.
And there's something really, really inspiring and exciting about seeing somebody who knows they're broken.
Yeah.
And channels that energy into walking onto a stage and writing, creating, directing, mm-hmm. executive producing, and starring in their own show every night and bringing a little bit of, you know, when Chris Rock wrote the special, Bring the Pain.
Right.
Which
was probably one of the best specials ever.
Yeah, like I haven't spoken to Chris about this particular thing. I've spoken to him a lot, but I would imagine it's a double meaning, because there's a lot of pain growing up. There's a lot of things that happen that make you funny, and probably the only person that I've ever met that, and he might disagree with me, that feels like there's not a lot of pain is Jerry Seinfeld.
Right.
He's like one of the few guys that it feels like there wasn't a lot of, you know, inner turmoil. I don't know. Yeah. I mean, I haven't spoken to him about it, but most people, you know, if you're Jim Jeffries, you don't think of the gun control bit or the bit of, I hope I pronounce this right, Oscar Petorich, the guy who had no legs and shot his model girlfriend. You don't do a routine where you're acting out the whole murder on stage. You're dragging yourself across the stage. If there isn't something inside that's going on, you know, that's happening. If you're, I just don't see, if you're an impressionist, for instance, like any great impressionist.
Like Rich Little.
Rich Little. By the way, Rich Little was banned in certain areas. People Rich don't realize Little. That.
Really?
But Rich in Canada, Little? There were certain cities he was banned in. People think he was only a G-rated comedian. But most impressionists who are really tremendous, and I have a rule that I wouldn't say anything unless they were in the room with me.
Right.
So, like, you take somebody like Melissa Villaseñor on SNL, who I represented for, I think, 8 years.
Oh, love her, Melissa.
Yeah, this and, guy has a restraining
I just
order
love
on
her.
I would imagine.
And or, when he met her, he's like, I know how to cook rice.
And beans.
Or like a Frank Caliendo or a Daryl Hammond. Normally, when you meet them, you rarely get that inside look. You know, it's more of a guarded thing. Now, I have a relationship with Melissa, which is different, and those people where I have seen other sides of them, which are amazing.
Yeah.
But normally, to the world, like if they go on a show or something, when they're at the height of doing their impressions and whatever it is, you don't really see necessarily who they are. You're seeing things channeled in. You know, Robin Williams would go on stage, get standing ovations.
Yeah.
How often did you ever see the side of Robin? Well, Bobcat Goldthwait was his best friend. He probably saw that side, but very few people did. So I love that about comedy. I love the management side. I'll tell you what I don't like about it. What I don't like about it is there's constant themes in representing people that you deal with all the time, and they're the same themes that happen over and over again.
Right.
And when I say I don't like them, that's probably a bad word. What I'll say is they're my least favorite parts of the job.
Right.
Which are the fact that there isn't any comic that I've ever met that hasn't said at one point in time, God, you know, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, and this guy got that, and that girl got that, and how come they got that, and I didn't get that? Or they'll say something like, God, I did this comedy club, it was half full, is it ever going to be full? I mean, how am I going to get to the point where it's sold out? How am I going to get my first television appearance? How am I going to get my first movie? What is it ever going to happen?
Right.
I've had men and women, you know, and it's part of the job. It's like, because you're part guru, part therapist, part whatever, you have people who get very passionate about their craft. They, you know, they some get angry, some cry. But in the end, if I'm believing in somebody, I always know what's going to happen. I know what can happen. I've seen it happen. One of the things that's going to sound probably disingenuous, and I don't mean it to be, is that, you know, look, you do something once, you know, you're lucky.
Yeah.
You do something twice, it's a fluke.
Right.
You do something three times, you know, it's a coincidence.
Right.
But I managed probably over 10 people that went from a studio apartment to extraordinary heights.
Right.
Like that people only dream of. And so I know the formula. I know what happens. I know with their talent and my talent, I need to be a chameleon.
Right.
And I need to figure out how I'm going to represent them. How I represent Dave Chappelle for 8 years is different than I'm going to represent Mike Epps, and how I represent Mike Epps is different from how I represent Louis Anderson.
Yeah.
And Louis Anderson is different than Tracy Morgan.
Yeah.
And Tracy Morgan is different than Louis C.K. And Louis C.K. is different than Wanda Sykes. And Wanda Sykes is different than Dane Cook. And you have to be able to move like the ocean, sort of like a comedian moves when they do a set. You know, you every audience is different.
Yeah.
Every artist is different. And you have to use the tools that are in my toolbox to be able to help them get to the next level. And I always know that I can do it. I always know that there's always going to be a next person. It always happens. And I've never, you know, I've never not seen it happen. Like when I worked with Dane Cook and we had such an amazing run, it was easy to think that that would never happen again, where you have somebody who does so well or has that kind of success. And then I met Whitney Cummings at a Sundance Film Festival, and she was interviewing people on the street.
Yeah.
And I met her, and I, as I always do, and I shook her hand, and I always feel something. It's like the dead zone.
Right.
I didn't feel it with Alan.
Darn it. Darn it.
But,
that's
but
the best 5-minute joke.
But I normally... He hates me. But I normally feel it. And when I shook Whitney's hand, I said to her, I said, look, I have this weird feeling that you are gonna, you can do stand-up. You can write. You can act. You can host. You can do so many different things. And she said, I've never really done that before. I said, well, you can and you will. And at the height, you know, she wrote and created and was on the air with 3 shows.
Yeah, I think she's one of the best female comics right now.
Yeah, so, and she, you know, hard worker. She's the kind of person who, you know, it wouldn't surprise me if she was taking a shower with a Ziploc bag and her iPhone inside of it.
Yeah,
wow. that's quite an image.
So that's the...
So, would it be a better image if she cooked rice?
Oh,
that's right.
There we go. There's creativity on this podcast. It's why I'm here.
This guy has so many callbacks. He has callback waiting. So in terms of stand-up, I do love that, but there's always the... Every artist has that feeling, like, you know, even yourself, you've been doing it 14 years.
Yeah.
I can guarantee you, you're asking yourself, well, fuck, I've been doing it 14 years. How come that guy got Conan after 3 years and I've been doing it 14 years?
You're right.
It's not his time. It's my time. Or you might see somebody get a sitcom and you're like, well, you know, how come I'm not auditioning for that? Why shouldn't I? I'm that type. Yeah. I can do that. And, I was just sitting with a comedian who shall remain nameless. Just every single, probably 5 minutes, there was another phrase that came out of his mouth. You know, I started with a lot of guys who are doing a lot of great things right now.
All right.
Okay, that's one. It's hard. I'm not really, you know, making that much money right now, and I need a manager. I need a manager really bad to help me get to the next level. No, you don't. I can name you 50 examples of people who didn't have a manager that got a manager from what they created.
Right.
Oh, well, let me show you this video of this guy I really like. He's got like millions of views. Oh, really? How many original things do you put up every week? Well, you know, I've been kind of busy, you know. How long have you been doing it? 7 years. Oh, do you have anything in 7 years you put up? Well, no, nothing. But I'm going to.
Right.
It's like everybody has a story of why things aren't happening the way they're supposed to happen.
Yeah.
And there's always evidence that they build up of why it happened the way it did and why it isn't happening, so they can build their story, so they can, you know. And this isn't just younger people. I've worked with, like, people who've done amazing things that are, like, say things to me that they won't say to other people.
Yeah.
That you just be shocked, you know. How come I can't get a Netflix special? I don't know how to tell you this, but twice in the last year you had an hour audition in front of them, in front of a sold out place, and they said no twice to you.
Yeah.
Well, you know, they're saying yes to Mike Epps. Yeah. But they're saying no to you.
Right.
Well, you should be able to turn that around.
Right.
You know, you turn no's into yeses.
Right.
I said,
that's what you're known for.
Yeah, I said, yes, I do. But there's people in control, and they're deciding who's going to get and who's not. And they're deciding on content. Mm-hmm. And your content didn't move them. Maybe your content moves me,
but it doesn't move them.
Now, I have another comic who I shall remain nameless because I don't want to say this, yeah. who I shot an hour special with, and I thought, this is a slam dunk, and I pitched to every network, and every network passed. I went back again the second time, a third time, a fourth time, a fifth time. Everyone passed. And I'm like, God, this is bad. Because I've sold like 37 out of 38 hour specials. I mean, I it's the best ratio that I have in my book of business. That's
my best percentage.
Like that's what I'm like, a you know, it's like a fielding percentage in baseball, but at mm-hmm. the, you know, if you're trying to sell television show is scripted, you know, I might be less than, you know, on the Mendoza line, if you know what that is in baseball. That's under 200%. That's only under 20%. But the point I'm trying to make is that, so I was in Montreal, and I knew the guy from Showtime was up there, and I asked him for coffee, and I asked him at a table in a corner. I set a table in a corner where he could sit with his back against the corner, and I sat in front of him, and I had him cornered.
Right.
And I essentially said, I'm not leaving this table until you give me a commitment for that guy. You have nothing to lose.
Yeah.
Nothing to lose and everything to gain. I don't care how much money you give me. You can give me $6 and a bucket of chicken. I want this guy on the air with a commercial. And we got him on the air.
Wow.
So I love, long answer, but I love comedy. I love comedians. But a lot of comedians complicate winning.
Right.
And the way, and I'll just ramble a little more because I want to share this with you. Like,
no.
Like the way people deal with hecklers on stage, you can kind of feel what kind of person they are in real life. So in other words, like the person that heckles a comedian, the comedian just doesn't do anything. They just ignore it and keep going.
Right.
That might be how they deal with things in their life. Then there's the person who heckles and the comedian just doesn't even tell a joke. They're just like lash out at the person until they, you know, sulk out of there.
Yeah.
Then there's the person who goes on and uses biting killer comedy to diffuse the situation.
In your face,
just constantly slinging those jokes.
Right.
And then there's the people like guests of yours, like Harlan Williams. You can tell what kind of person he is.
Yeah.
Because when somebody heckles Harlan Williams, it's a whole different thing. Like somebody will yell out the worst thing to Harlan Williams, and he'll just look down and say, hey, little buddy, listen, I understand you got some things to work out, and we're here as a group, and I'll just be your therapist, and this will be group therapy, little buddy, and we'll try to work things out. We'll try to help you through this, okay? So what seems to be the problem? And so he'll take a whole different way where he'll, and that's the way he is.
I'm kind of like you in a way because, like, I mean, you're very persistent, and Harlan Williams, you know, you brought him up. He's a great example. He's one of my favorite comics, and I have dreams of opening up for him. Right. So
He doesn't have dreams of you opening up for him, unfortunately. But that's going to happen. You can open up for him. He's a great guy and a wonderful guy. Yeah. And so why don't you open up for him? Because you can.
Yeah, yeah.
Have you asked him?
I haven't asked him.
Stop for a second. Stop one second.
All right.
Because this is important for your audience.
Right.
Okay. How long have you wanted to open for Harlan Williams?
How many years? Ever since I wanted to be a comic.
Okay, so 14 years at least. 14 years you wanted to open up for Harlan Williams. Time out. So, okay, you told me on the phone before the podcast that, in your opinion, you've been really good for the last 5 of those years.
Yes.
So let's just pretend that, let's forget the first 9.
That I've been doing it for 5 years.
And say 5 years you've been confident and you do great, and you feel great about yourself. So in 5 years, how many gigs do you think Harlan Williams has done?
Oh, in 5 years?
What would you take a guess?
I would say...
How many shows?
I would say 3,000 to 5,000.
5,000.
Yeah.
So you haven't asked him one fucking time, and he's done 5,000 shows. And that's what you... What you're an example of so many comedians, because it's like, if you don't ask, you don't
know.
Get.
Yeah.
So you have a dream for 14 fucking years to open for the guy, and you never
Why
ask
are you laughing?
Him.
No, I'm enjoying this.
Like it
makes I'm
no,
really enjoying this, by
no
the way.
It makes no sense at all.
No, no.
You ask him to do the podcast, he does the podcast. Mm-hmm. Well, why wouldn't you ask him to do, look, I just want to do a set on your thing, even if it's just for 5 minutes, can I do it? And then he says no, and then you ask him again, you send him a video or do whatever.
Yeah.
This is what the thing that... Most people listening, they don't get, like, I think to myself, like, people worry about getting jobs. Like, there's people listening to this podcast who wonder, okay, I'm out of work. How am I going to get that next job? Whether they're in comedy or not. And they don't understand that the more things they go out for, the better shot they have. So just if you'll bear with me.
No, definitely.
Because this is important.
Yeah.
So, let's just pretend you put a list together of all the people who you'd like to open for. How many people would be on that list? You don't have to mention the names.
Oh, well, there's five, and I've already opened up for four of them.
Great. Okay, how many times have you asked those four?
Several.
Okay, why haven't you asked Harlan?
Honestly, because the days he was working was the days I was doing shows with, like, Norm or Hotz or something.
Keith.
No, seriously.
Keith.
That's the truth.
5 years of shows, and you were busy every time he had a show.
That he was in town, yeah. Yeah. But I got him to do the podcast. I asked him like 5 times to do that. Each time he said no.
But he said yes.
The fifth time, yeah.
All right. So,
what's the batting average on that? That's 20%, right?
No, your batting average is great for asking people. It's 80%.
Oh,
so that's good.
But he said no 4 times.
So no, but I mean, it's just he said no, but it doesn't matter how many times
they
say
keep
no
asking.
Because you keep asking. But the thing is, with people going out for jobs, like they think, okay, well, you ask them, like, okay, you want to be an architect. Great. How many places have you applied to? Oh, 50. Oh, that's great. How did you apply? Did you send them a handwritten note? Did you send them a letter? No, applied online. Well, anybody, when you apply online, can just press delete. You got to reach out to them with a package.
Yeah.
And I always tell anybody who's out there, the easiest way to do this, and it's a great thing that I always tell people to do, is that you write a cover letter that's I'm not suggesting you're going to write a letter to Harlan Williams,
no.
But I'm talking about in other situations.
Right.
So you write a letter that's completely original to the person. So let's say you want to work in the entertainment business and you want to work at a major studio. So you identify 20 studios that you want to work for. One is Lionsgate, let's say.
Okay.
And you just write a letter to them saying, you know, your three favorite movies that you've ever watched are Monsters Ball and, you know, 3:10 to Zuma and Leprechaun.
They should probably be movies with Lionsgate, though.
There you go. Those are movies with
Lionsgate. Oh, are they?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought the
Monsters Ball.
Oh, I thought you said Monsters, Inc. I was like, I thought
Monsters
that was Disney.
Ball.
Okay.
So the thing is, you identify what the things are that you loved in those films, and you make it seem like this is all you want to work is at Lionsgate, and you know these are your favorite movies. And then you put your resume in, which is great. You have your own stationery for all, and you have 3 letters of recommendation you put in. And this is what I tell people to do. Go to FedEx. Let's say you're applying to 20 places. Get 20 envelopes, 20 slips. Make them all out. Bend them up. Put magic marker on them. And hire somebody to deliver all 20.
Wow.
And just when they get there, just say, hi, I work at Jamba Juice. This is for Michael Burns at Lionsgate. Is this the right place? Yeah, just leave it right here. Everybody opens a FedEx. It's like a $45 mm-hmm. message.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
And so you get that in the hands of the right people. You could have 3 or 4 going to the same company.
Right.
And CC'd each one. And so they're going to know you. They're going to pass it on to their human resources person and say, this person sent me a FedEx. You know, bring them in or do whatever. And then you're going to get your audience with them. You should get more of an audience than you do if you go on the internet. And then once you get there, again, as I say, if you go in the room, you blow them the fuck away, and you're undeniable, you're going to get the gig. You're going to get offered the gig. And let's pretend that you suck in 19 interviews, but the 20th one you're great in, you're in. And we talked a little bit about this before. Yeah. It's like, if I could play the lottery every day and have a 1 in 20 chance of winning,
yeah,
I'd get there. Like, you look at the people you've opened for. You know, what are your chances of opening for them? Well, look what happened. You got to open for them. You will open for Harlan Williams. You just haven't asked.
Yeah.
And you could open for him at a... It doesn't... You have to have to open for him in L.A. You don't just open for Norm MacDonald in L.A.
Well, when I first started, yeah, I did.
I know.
Oh,
14
right.
14 years
oh,
in.
Okay, right.
You could offer to open up for Harlan when he's doing Fort Lauderdale and just say, hey, listen, I'll fly myself there. I'll put myself up. You can pay me whatever you want to pay me. I'll show you that I can do the job. And that's it. And that's how you form these relationships and you go. There are certain artists that don't want relationships mm-hmm. with anybody. They don't want to get close to anybody. Mm-hmm. They feel like every single person that comes into their life is another chance that something could fuck up.
Right.
So you'll notice, I'm not going to mention any names, there's some comedians who've risen and fallen really hard that haven't put a community around them.
Right.
They've isolated themselves. And so it's easier to get attacked that way than when you have the community. Like Joe Rogan has a tremendous community. It's like the Lorne Michaels of podcasting. Yeah. Anybody who goes on his show is immediately endorsed. And if he has them on again and again, their careers become tremendous. Yeah. Chelsea Handler is that kind of person who gave the chance to so many great young artists. And yes, you know, sometimes some of them walked on eggshells when she was there, but, you know, it happens. You know, you got to learn how to mix with certain people. Norm MacDonald, as you know,
yeah,
when he was at Saturday Night Live, he had no fear of Lorne Michaels.
Yeah.
Now, granted, he got taken out of the show at a certain point, but I don't think that hurt him at that point because I think that everybody knew how brilliant he was. But, you know, Will Ferrell didn't care. You know, he just did what he wanted to do. He had confidence in his greatness.
Yeah.
Melissa Villaseñor told me something that was kind of funny with Lorne, because he's so funny and he's such a genius. But, you know, as an artist, sometimes you just don't know where you stand. And Melissa had gone through all the thing with the, you know, with that thing in the press that happened to her. And
The Twitter stuff?
Yeah, and so, yeah. And she hadn't really talked to him in months. He hadn't said anything to her. She was on the show. She was doing things, but... And she goes into an elevator alone, like they're going to the party, but she's alone in the elevator, and all of a sudden, cast start filing in, the elevator's packed, and then Lorne comes on the elevator, and it's like 20 floors down, and, you know, nothing, no one's saying anything halfway down, and then right before it hits the bottom, Lorne just says this gem. He says, everybody, let's not share what we really feel about Melissa in this elevator. and I'm paraphrasing, but it was something like that. And it was just, you know, just he's a master. And you know, it's like, and I'm Lorne Michaels has, you know, done more for artists that I've worked for than done more for artists that I don't work with.
Yeah.
It's just, what is it, 47 years, 50 years? I mean, it's crazy. It's like, it's just so special to be there and to know that. That's one of the things in my career that I will always look at wonderfully, is that to walk through those hallways as a young manager and, you know, longer in the tooth as a manager and you know, be around, you know, standing next to Kurt Cobain before he goes on, or watching, you know, Jim Brewer get ready to go on and see his process, or Daryl Hammond doing, you know, Clinton, or Tracy Morgan, or Jay Moore, or it's just Dane Cook hosting the opening show of a season. And just, you know, these things, you can't even believe what's happening when you're there. This show is something out of, like, it's something like out of the old school. And there's people who are writing cue cards. Their only jobs is to write cue cards.
Yeah.
And changing and doing it. If you see these people, observe these people, you'd be blown away. Like, how many people would even know what a cue card is now?
Yeah, exactly.
And these shows, you know, a lot of times the dress rehearsal shows, you know, there's so much anxiety. You're trying to do well as an artist. You want to get on the live show. Things are going to get cut. You're killing yourself. And a lot of times things fall flat in the dress rehearsal. And it gets done. And I remember in between shows, I'd sort of sit down away from everybody. And I'd think to myself, how is the show ever going to come together?
Yeah.
And in a span of 45 minutes to an hour, Lorne and his team would put it together in a way that just blew me away. And it's just, it's you know, these things that you can study as a comedian and look at, you can study so many different things about the business, and it really, you have everything available to you to do so, where most people didn't have that in the past. You'd have to look at a VHS tape of somebody, you know, and now you can see the opening sets on television of certain people. And I know I'm rambling, but I think this is important because...
No, it's very important.
Like I just watched a Cat Williams special from Jacksonville, Florida. I think it was his last special. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
And, you know, he does 20 minutes on Jacksonville, and at the end he does 10 minutes... on his dick. Okay, now
it's a good transition.
And I'm not shitting on Cat Williams.
No,
because Cat Williams is a genius. But this special, when you watch it, and I'm laughing, it's funny, but it's everything in it that I would tell every comic I ever met with or ever gave guidance to. You don't do that.
Yeah.
Don't do 10 minutes on your dick. Don't come and try to make it and do 20 minutes on L.A.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, it's just, don't do it. But Cat Williams has proven himself as a stream of consciousness, you know. He's just incredible, you know. And he people love him so much, not just because of his original voice.
And his dick
or whatever, or the way he does it. But if you watch him, it's like you see that he's working so hard. Now, somebody might make a joke, well, you know, he's not working, he just sweats like that or whatever. But you get the feeling that he's really giving everything he has for you.
Yeah.
So when I watch that, I would tell every comic, you can't do that, don't do that. But it's like... Chappelle, I was watching a special from him recently where he said did it from San Francisco. And he starts off the special, it's the gayest town ever. It's like I'm in, you know, whatever, God's anus or whatever it is. And again, you know, if you're a comic out there, you can't do that.
Yeah.
But Chappelle has paid his dues.
Right.
He's done so many hours and hours and hours of the greatest comedy, from the crack baby, you know, the four-year-old in diapers selling crack to, I mean, I remember one of the first jokes when he was 18, you know, I loved the joke, I can't say it on the air, but it was like, he's like, you know, it's known that black people say the N-word, and I took my white friend to a party.
Right.
And everybody's walking around. I'm walking, and hey, what's up, man? What's up, man? What's up, man? My white friend got all excited. Hey, what's up, man? Hey, the music stopped. People look at him. He got his ass kicked that night. I mean, I hated to do it to him, but I mean, everybody was looking at me. You know, so he always had these unique things, but now he can do anything. He can do the joke. I went to see him with my son at Radio City Music Hall.
Oh, yeah.
And he comes out, this is what no one, I don't think anybody can, he comes out as the day after Charlottesville. Okay. And he stands on stage, he walks out, takes out a cigarette, smokes. You're not allowed to smoke indoors, except if you're Chappelle.
Yeah.
And he says, listen, I'm sorry, everybody, but I have to talk about what happened last night in Charlottesville and what's going on the last few days. I think it was a couple days before. I'm sorry, but I have to get this off my chest. And for 30 minutes, he's talking about Charlottesville, and he's killing. It's like an old Def Jam where people are standing up, high-fiving each other, running around. It's like insane stuff that he's never done before.
Yeah.
And he's killing, not for 5, not for 10, not 50, 30 minutes. And I'm with my son, and I just can't believe what I'm seeing. You know, a true genius. Then he stops, he takes another cigarette, and he says this line, which he does on his special. He says, and I'm paraphrasing, he says, I'm 44 years old, I'm getting old. You know, when you're getting old, guys, you're alone in your room, doors closed, you get out the lotion, you start touching yourself, and then halfway through you just say, fuck it, I'm going to sleep. And then he gets a huge laugh there, and then he does 30 minutes more of the most brilliant stuff ever. Thank you, good night. Yeah. I go backstage, and I guess I have this kind of relationship with him. He spends like, this was what was really amazing about Dave Chappelle, too, and I just share this with, and Cat Williams, too, and I'll tell you. So I'm backstage. There's 200 people backstage, you know.
Right.
I'm in the corner by the wall. My son, he walks in. My son says, let's go over to talk to him. I said, Zion, let's just...
Dave's busy.
Let's just stay right here against the wall. I have a feeling everything will happen the way you want it to happen. He walks in, and he comes right over to us. And he spends a lot of time with my son. And I say to him, listen, you know, you got a lot of people here. He said, no, I know you're always going to have a question for me, Barry, and I want you to stay after and talk to me, too, so you can go and come back. I said, well, I do have a question for you. He said, what is it? I said, I just want to understand something. You do 30 minutes of the most unbelievably original new stuff on Charlottesville, and then you follow that up with 30 minutes of the most incredible stuff you're working on, presumably for your special. But then your bridge joke is a dick joke that almost any comedian could think of or do. Granted, you do it in your way, and it's probably funnier than 20 times funnier, 100 times funnier than anybody else, but it's not something that when you hear the joke, you're like, wow, that is a master. And he looked at me, and he smoked the cigarette, took a puff out, and he said, Barry, man, sometimes I like to do a joke for me. And I thought that was really amazing, because at this stage of the game, he can do that. After Chris Rock did his, I think it was his third or fourth special, I happened to be backstage when he came off stage, and he said, what do you think? And I'm one person's opinion. I just say what I say. I'm not a yes person. I'm just going to say what I say. And I said, the special is brilliant. It's unbelievable, incredible. But I do have to ask you, you did open up with about 10 minutes of Michael Jackson jokes. Like, I'm kind of confused why you did Michael Jackson jokes. You can do anything. And he looked at me and he said, Barry, I stand by those Michael Jackson jokes because I know that they're original the way I write them, and no one's going to do better Michael Jackson jokes than me. I said, I know that, but they're Michael Jackson jokes, and it's a premise that totally different from every other premise you did was nobody could ever do. I mean, this is a guy who did the tambourine premise.
Right.
Who in the world has ever taken the word tambourine and united it with a theme of marriage and relationships? And but he was doing 10 minutes of Michael Jackson jokes.
Right.
And he said, look, Barry, I've paid my dues. I've proven myself. I can do you know, the original stuff. And if I want to do 10 minutes on Michael Jackson, I'm going to do 10 minutes on Michael Jackson. I'm going to do it better than anybody else, and I'm committed to that.
Ah.
And I said, that's fair. And so, again, a long way to go, but the reason why I love comedy is I love being around these people. These people are incredible, incredible artists, and the greatest thing for your audience listening. Look, you go to a rock and roll show, you're never going to talk to Steven Tyler. You're never going to talk to, you know, whoever you love, Cher or Nine Inch Nails or, well, Axl Rose. If you get to them, you're going to get to them because you know somebody, you know somebody, and you maybe you'll shake their hand. If you love comedy as an artist and you're a young comic, or you're an audience member, or you're a fan, you just go to the Comedy Store, walk out to the bathroom, and just stand next to the wall in the hallway, and you can walk up to Chris Rock and say, "Hey, Chris, how are you doing? I'm a big fan. I want to ask you about this," or, "I'm starting comedy. I have this thing that I was thinking about. What do you think?" And they will sit or stand there, and they will give you some of their time. What other thing, art form, do you have where you can mingle and hang out with the greatest comedians in the world who work out in these places?
Yeah.
And be an open micer or a fan, or just bring your parents down. I remember my ex-wife, I brought her parents to see George Carlin work out his set at the Comedy Magic Club. And, you know, after the show, went like nothing. I just walked back, and they're talking to George Carlin for a half hour.
Right.
It's like, that's why I love comedy. It's an accessible art form that also lets people know in the world that people go through the same kind of pain they do. As Jon Stewart once eloquently said, he said, "I don't understand why black people and Jewish people don't get along. We both had the same pain. The only difference is, you know, black people learned how to put it to music." And, you know, and
that's
so...
That's funny.
That's good.
And so, in essence, that's what comedy brings, and I'll always have an affinity for it, and I'll always love it. And the reason why I do industry standard is because...
It's actually one of... Besides this... That's my favorite podcast.
I bet you say that to all lesbians.
No, I'm serious. Like, I actually love my podcast, but yours is my second favorite podcast. I listen to it all the time. So
that means a lot to me, man.
But we are running out of time, and I do want to like give you a compliment, because I've talked to you on the phone a couple times, and, you know, just sitting here, and hanging out with you, I don't think you know how positive you are to comedy, or maybe you do and no one's ever told you this, so I'd like to tell you this. Everyone you've ever managed, you know, you're a big part of their career, and you've helped people who aren't in comedy cheer up because you've helped them. So you're very, very powerful, and, you know, I love you very much because you've helped all these comics who've helped so many people just with the spirit of laughter, and you're a big key of that. So thank you very much for that.
Well, that means a lot coming from you. I wish it had come from Alan, but...
He does. You don't make rice.
No, I don't. You see what I just did there? I did a bad thing.
You tried to do a joke.
No, I did a bad thing there.
What?
I didn't take the love.
Yeah.
And I'm going to reset and thank you so much. It really means a lot to me.
Because I don't think anyone's ever... Maybe they've told you that, but I don't think you've ever been... You know what I mean? You've actually really realized that. You know what I mean?
Well, I don't, and I have a lot of things about myself that are like comedians, and that I don't. I know my place, but I don't accept it. I'm always, if I will share something with you that I probably shouldn't share, because it's completely against everything.
As much as I want to hear it, is it going to be fast? Because we have the light.
Oh, okay.
So
no, it is fast. I'll just share with you that.
Okay, share.
I'll just share with you that I just feel like when I get up in the morning, what drives me is thinking, okay, it's all going to go away. And what can I do today to help it get better? And the podcast helps me tell the stories and allow comedians the license to tell their story, which is the greatest gift in the world. And you're doing great stuff, you and Alan, and it's an honor to be here. And I truly mean it. I'm sorry I rambled so much.
No. I'm just glad that got to meet you, and you know, it was awesome having you, and I'm glad that you now know how much you mean to comedy, you know, just by being the guy. You know, you've done a lot, you know what I mean? And that was what I really wanted to tell you, because I think you've never, maybe you've realized it, but I think you've never really known that. So I just wanted you to know that.
It really means a lot, and congratulations on your show. You're kicking ass, and you deserve everything you have, and just keep going, keep plugging ahead, and set those goals, and tick them off the list one by one. And before you know it, you're going to have everything you want in life.
Oh, well, thanks, Barry.
Thank you.
Is there a place where the folks can follow you on Facebook or Twitter?
Just at Barry Katz, or just at Jew Israel. No, I'm kidding. Oh. It's at Barry Katz.
Obviously, you could follow Alan at Give Me Rice.
It's not true.
Okay, guys. If you like the show, subscribe, rate, and review on iTunes. You could also follow us on social media at Reza Riffs. I have two stand-up shows coming up Friday, the 24th, at the Rec Room with Angelo Zaroukas. 8 p.m. tickets could be purchased at www.recroomhb.com. And then Saturday, the 25th, at the Hollywood Improv with Jay Moore. Tickets could be purchased at www.hollywood.improv.com.
Saturday, 25th.
Yes. So, and then all other shows, www.keithreza.com. Barry, thank you so much for being here. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Barry Katz.
Thank you, guys.
See you guys next time.
Yes.
You're listening to Reza Riffs with Keith Reza and Alan Lee right here on LA Talk Radio.